Well, this is going to be a great session. We actually submitted this a little while ago, and it's become a much more relevant topic today. So definitely something that has a lot of interest. We're going to cover this from many different angles, but both covering privacy and security implications of facial recognition. We're going to do it from a consumer-based angle. We're going to do it from corporate. We're going to mix a little bit of government in there and have some things that people should be thinking about. I'm Chris Pierson, CEO of Binary Sun Cyber Risk Advisors. Previously, I was Chief Privacy Officer for Royal Bank of Scotland and a prior General Counsel, and also CISO for fintech payment companies. So we're gonna mix legal, we're gonna mix privacy, we're gonna mix cyber in here, we're gonna mix engineering, we're gonna mix a lot of different things and a lot of different things on identity. So I'm joined today by Jim Shreve.
Hello, everybody. I'm Jim Shreve. I'm counsel with BuckleySandler, based in the Chicago office, and I advise a lot of financial institutions and others on cybersecurity and privacy issues, including facial recognition.
Yeah, so this is going to be good. I mean, for how many people is this an interesting topic, something that's new, something you're, yeah, all right, yep, good, all right. The tech guys are onto it, too. Good. So we're going to talk a lot of things. We're going to talk a little bit about technology. The technology session could be a 1 hour, 2 hour session in and of itself. We're gonna have to go quick over it, we're happy to stick around. We're gonna talk about how this is impacting you in your home and personal lives, out in government, public, right, in that quasi-public space, quasi-private space, and some of the different enhancements there. Corporate environment, lots of fun, really cool, interesting applications here, right? Lots that enable further security, and also ones that are hitting up against some laws in some different areas. We'll talk a little bit about legal themes. We're not going to go super deep into this area. There are definitely some areas of concern, some different lawsuits that are going on, some different things to track. This presentation is well ahead of the curve in terms of identifying some of these issues. So the story is yet unwritten on a lot of these different issues, especially how the states are looking at it. And we're going to talk about some really cool and sometimes funky controls. This is always a little bit crazy.
Yeah, thanks, Chris. This shows something. It's a Microsoft Azure product, and having trouble with this video here, but if I can't, it's not getting me a cursor.
Can you get the,
no.
Here, let's do it.
You'll see the right-hand screen if you pay attention to it. It will scroll down some of the different variables.
Go.
Let's see. There we go.
Okay. Well, I think I'm just going to have to click. Okay. So it shows this is a face recognition scan of this person here. And usually you think, okay, it picks up, you know, it determines who this person is, or maybe it tries to determine who they are, but it picks up a whole lot more. As you can see here, it's picking up information about her hair, and it says, okay, it's not invisible, you can see it. Here you can see about, you know, the color of her hair, and the confidence level in these various attributes. I can see, you know, how much pitch does she have in her, here's her estimated age. She does not have a mustache. She is wearing eye makeup and lip makeup. And you can see here, that was an interesting thing that just scrolled up. You could see an estimate of what her mood is and the likely confidence level in that mood. Then here you can see, this is the more typical stuff. It's showing where on the grid these various attributes are for her. So you can see it picks up a lot more than just who she is. It's picking up a lot more in terms of, you know, what state is she in at that time. And so this is a lot of information, and there's certainly a lot you can do with it. And so we're gonna kind of go through what some of those things are.
How many people knew that it picks up all of that right now? Yeah, a few of us, I felt that in our stomachs, but it's really cool to actually see it. So about the technology, I mean, there's a lot here. Early biometrics really started on just, right, finding the two eyes, tracking the two eyes, finding approximately where the nose is, maybe where the mouth is, and that's about it. We've moved much, much further beyond that, in terms of the actual technology and its uses. Obviously, for access, authentication, for auditing, both internally in terms of access to systems, access to physical places, as well as access to devices, right? We couldn't have timed the iPhone 10 any better And we'll talk about a little bit of its technology and how it's actually doing that sensing. But these are some of the definite positive uses that enhance the overall security posture and the controls that you can have within a company. Just about every single device, right? If you look at your iPads, your different tablets, your phones, some of the phones, and all of your different laptops. I mean, the number of, how many people picked up 200 camera blockers on the show floor this week? Come on, you did. It's fine. You can admit it. Yeah. So, I mean, me too. Cameras are just about on everything. The ability to bake this technology into every single piece of device that we have and hold is just kind of crazy. And it's going to be one of the main means of egress and authentication that we actually have. It obviously helps out with NIST in the 800 series. It's going to help out on GDPR. It helps out on every single access control methodology that we have. It also is potentially, right, one of those things in terms of access to records, access to data stores, access to troves of information, data warehousing, and all the rest. It also is potentially privacy enhancing. And I know that seems backwards, but if you are able to have those further biometric or stepped up authentication instead of username, password, instead of dual factor, instead of right just presuming that someone is who they say they are because they're at their terminal, if you're able to have those biometric stamps, you're able to further include privacy enhancements into the actual data and the places that are actually being accessed.
Sure. Thanks, Chris. Now, right now I would describe in some ways the whole process of facial recognition is a bit like chili. That there's certain basic ingredients, but everybody's doing it a little bit differently. And so if you look at the image here on the right, on the left, you can see various points that might be scanned in order to determine who someone is. But if you look back here in the previous one, you can see they're using different points. And then it actually changes considerably more when you get into the next step, which is it's taking these points and applying an algorithm to them to then break it down into some numerical value that can then be stored. Those algorithms are being done very differently at this point. And so to some extent, you could say the privacy of this is being protected, and to some extent the security, because there's so little standardization at this point in the process, that everybody has their own proprietary process, and the result is that nobody can read each other's stuff. Now you can see one of the additional points here on the images on the right, it's a facial recognition scan of Sylvester Stallone. And in spite of it being scary in some of the images, you can see that it also is showing how it uses the three dimensions to determine some of the factors about him, how it's not a flat thing. Because using three dimension is key to making sure that it's not spoofed, which is something we'll talk about a little bit later on.
So, go ahead.
Oh, sure. As you can see, anything that's picking up these kind of values necessarily has certain risks. The FTC certainly has been looking into the concept that you could use a fair lending type analysis in other areas, whereas fair lending saying, okay, are you having disparate impact on a protected class because of the terms of the loan that you're giving, the amounts, the payments, the interest rate, and so forth. That same kind of analysis could be put into other areas. So if you're pricing a product, are you pricing it differently for people of different races? You could easily pick up several of these features from a facial recognition. And so then the question is this working into your algorithm for how you price the product or the terms on which you present the product or what products you present to people? Is it being done on some discriminatory way? And that's certainly something at least the previous FTC administration has been looking to. We have a wholesale changeover now in the next couple of months, and we'll have to see if they continue that. But and if they don't, I think you might see state attorneys general looking at this kind of thing as well.
And also here, and we have some links at the back for more information. There are at least two studies out there. There's an MIT study from February, and there's a Georgetown Law study from around about September, October. Our links are at the back. There's some biases here that in terms of the quality of the scanning and some issues. Folks with darker skin, right, there's a little bit of a higher percentage of incident rate of false positives in terms of measuring the depth that the different features of the face are at. So you have a little bit of more problem there in terms of some false positives. Same thing is in terms of men fare better than women in general in terms of facial recognition. So darker skin in women is going to be potentially an area where there is higher false positives. The studies are new. The studies have lower size data sets, but something that certainly we should be all abreast of, keep abreast of. Physical differences, you know, the whole, well, just throw a mustache on, just throw on eyeglasses. Yes, defeating technology in 2002, 2005, 2007. Now, not as much. It's actually really, really interesting. The number of dots that are being measured on the face are much more precise. And so, you know, the introduction of different types of disguises are actually not able to totally fake the system. This was I think it was Wired. Is when this where this came out, but you know, this was a great, you know, making a clay a paper mache image of the face and overlaying high quality images captured all the depth differences with sufficient specificity. They were able to crack through the iPhone 10 in the first, I think it was the first week. Lighting also can play a role. Where these are being used in terms of a formal setting, so we're not talking about just off of some street camera type of thing, but in a formal setting, an airport, a court, a high security location, lighting is absolutely key. I mean, as I egress right here, I'm in much better lighting. I can kind of see the blurriness as I move out, right? You're gonna get a lot more shadows. Lighting definitely has an impact. So home and personal use. So it used to be way back when, you know, right, the D-Link camera that you had to figure out what to do, punch a hole in the firewall, you know, open up a port and go ahead and hook in, and you could go ahead and surveil your home, and you only had one camera because it was $300. And that's really changed. It's really massively changed with a number of the different camera systems that are out now in terms of being able to have them anywhere inside the house and externally. But more so, have them actually be smart devices. So a number of cameras have recently gotten upgrades in terms of their analytics and the AI engines. AWS, just back at their reInvent conference in November, opened up some of their AI engines, and it works great in some of the camera technology. But recognizing whether it's a person or a dog, recognizing whether they've seen, that camera has seen that individual before or not, whether it's a stranger, right? Son, daughter come home from high school, but it's three people. Is that person there one of the best friends that you know that's always over the house, or, you know, one of these new friends? Who is the new friend type of thing? Right, great applications in terms of facial recognition, the AI and machine learning that can be had from that. And obviously, when you take it to the next step, I mean, think about it. Ring, just purchased by whom? There are quiz questions here. Ring, purchased by who? Yeah, thank you. Okay, there we go. Everyone who answered that gets a free ring. Jim will have them. He'll be out back. Yeah, I will be somewhere else. Right, so you now have the Ring devices, seeing every single doorstep, right, lining the rows of homes in the community model, and now perhaps, right, hooking in with AWS, hooking in with facial recognition, right, the bad guy that came by and, you know, threw a stone through each front door and walked in, right, you're going to be able to do some great, interesting things. There. The application of these cameras in terms of appliances, so moving throughout your home, not just a camera on a camera, but a camera on an Amazon Echo, a camera on some other device, right? Cameras actually being embedded in multiple different. My Ecobee has a motion sensor, right? When you walk past it, you know, hey, how's it going? Here's the temperature. Here's the temperature inside. Here's the temperature outside. Right? We can take that one step further. You know, Chris is home, so he likes it super cold. His wife is home. She doesn't. Right, so raise the temperature. In terms of access to devices, you know, the biggest entree of this has been in terms of cell phone. Yes, on multiple different tablets and laptops, all the rest. The iPhone 10 really pushes forward in terms of its sensor and sensoring capabilities. Real quickly, I mean, what you may not recognize is, you know, not only an infrared camera, flood sensor, proximity sensor, so measuring where you are in distance. And then dot projector. The dot projector is super interesting, right? 300 points of light, 300 measurements on your face, right? That's getting you the depth and clarity. Really, really phenomenal jumps and advances in technology. Think about that being in the vehicle, in your home, all the rest. Really, really you know, amazing array of data gathering points on the phone, on the device that we all have and hold. So yeah. So Jim, sure. This goes right. Lots of other uses beyond that.
Absolutely. In banking and healthcare, two very regulated industries. Banking, the use of biometrics for authentication is longstanding in the financial sector. Been used for many years. Many banks now have been using phones actually, and to be in lieu of the something you have. In lieu of an ATM card at ATMs now in the U.S., greatly increasing frequency. We're seeing that, but actually in China, for the last 5 years or so, a lot of banks have been using facial recognition instead of that. And so you go up to an ATM, it scans your face. It then sends a text message to your phone with a code. You type in the code, then you can access your account. Increasingly now we're seeing it in the Middle East. This is an ad for a bank in the Middle East talking about blinking to bank. It's becoming more and more prevalent. Even more interesting in healthcare, mHealth, a hospital in Scotland, has been piloting something for the last couple of years where they have a special camera and patients, when they come in the door, their face is being scanned. It can scan up to 6 people at a time. And it's grabbing some of their basic vital signs from this camera that it's scanning on them. And the idea is to eventually, in addition to being able to recognize people and pull up their records when they come in, is to be able to use it as part of the triaging process. So they'll be able to tell if people have particular conditions that need immediate attention, move them to the front of the line before anybody even sees them. So there's a tremendous amount of interesting uses being considered in both banking and particularly in healthcare.
What was when the avian flu was, 2009? Does anyone remember? Right, was it 2007, 2009, right? I think it had nods, I'm in the right area. Do you remember what they issued to all the folks at the airports, like Miami and JFK and Newark and, the major, probably San Fran too, right? Yeah, thermal imagers, right? The thermal imagers, watching the passengers coming off the plane, people not looking great from a transatlantic flight, but when they're coming across, they were scanning, right? This 98.6, 98.9, 100.1. Oops, you got to go into that room, sir, right? That's one of the big defensive tactics that they had. So easy to understand how they can combine not only the facial recognition with the other controls in there. I wonder what happens if you blink, so you blink to bank. I wonder, maybe someone is going to have to work on this. Maybe there's a secret code, like 3 blinks means that it's not really my buddy with me. I'm being, someone's got a knife in my back and they want money.
Yeah, it gets something in your eye and it starts shooting out money to you.
Yeah, that's going to be at the Innovation Sandbox next year. So we'll work on that. Social media, this is where it gets really, really, really interesting. So how many people are not on, like, super low presence, but not on social media? It's okay if you are. Oh, raise your hands a little higher. Yeah, okay. But you know what? All your friends, I'm sure that, maybe you have, your position is, I'm not really there, not posting a ton of pictures, but have you ever been in a photograph? Do you go to the parties? Do you go here? Do you go there? The number of pictures that have been taken from you, taken of you, you appear in those pictures. You appear in those images. Yes, you can tag yourself. You can identify yourself. You can push yourself out there. You can continuously do these things. More so, right, what's happening now is a lot of other people are just, they're tagging you. Whether or not you've elected to be tagged, right? They are tagging you. You may get a notification if you're on, but maintain a low profile. You may not know because you're not on one of those social media systems. But this actually does have privacy implications. It does have potential security applications. How are they using that picture? It used to be that transforming the 2D image into a 3D image, one that's capable of some essence of facial recognition and facial scanning, was just way, way too error prone, something that couldn't happen. And of course, with bad lighting and off angle and all the rest, but just even a general picture wasn't able to be as translated as well. Not so much anymore. The technology is much better there. The ability to figure out depth, figure out, because it's higher quality images, everyone essentially, right? You're not carrying around a separate camera, you're not converting it, you're not scanning in a physical picture. The raw data is the raw data, and folks are being able to, the engines are able to get a hold of that data much, much more. So this is where we get into some issues, and Jim's going to talk about some of the law and the legal issues here, but this is where we get into a little bit more of issues. Oh, well, I started that one. So we'll go with this one in terms of, I'll set it up, and then Jim can talk about the law. Minority Report, who remembers it? Okay, so your homework, take out your pens. Homework, hey, go watch Minority Report. I'm getting 5% of everyone who goes and downloads it this weekend. So Minority Report, Tom Cruise is walking through. It's actually looking, there was a thing where it flashed and you saw his eyes light up. Somewhere you'll see it, right? But it's keying in on his eye, the cameras are keying in. They're taking stock of who he is. I think it happens, yeah, right there, right? Little camera flash type of thing, right? Serving him up ads based off of his things that he likes that are in his portfolio, telling him what pair of jeans, I think it was, yes, we have your jeans over here, in the store. But all of this is extraordinarily doable, extraordinarily real, can easily be done right now in terms of facial recognition technology, serving up ads, serving up sales, telling you where you are. Hotels, once you get out and start walking in, they know that you're there, they know to, get the extra foam pillows up to your room, put the cookie on the nightstand, all the rest. I mean, this technology is absolutely 100% here and here right now. It's being used in a lot of different industries and cool places right now for more security. But, right, the applications apply everywhere. And what's interesting is that Illinois, Texas, and Washington mm-hmm. have some very, very stringent legal requirements around this that everyone might not be. How many people are aware of some of the different lawsuits in those areas? Yeah, it's kind of quiet. So not a lot. I think I saw like three hands raised. So,
yeah. The Minority Report came out 2001 or so.
One or two, yeah.
This was all very futuristic at that point. But 7 years later, in 2008, Illinois passed a law on biometrics privacy, the Illinois Biometrics Privacy Act, and so it. Came out of a sale, a threatened sale, of a database of fingerprints in bankruptcy, where a company was trying to maximize their assets, and they had a whole lot of fingerprints and thumbprints on people, and they were looking to sell that as an asset. Illinois lawmakers were appalled and passed a law, which in general requires notice and consent for the collection of biometric information. It also says you in the notice you have to specify what you're going to use it for, and very importantly, it creates a private right of action for violations of the law. So,
what does that mean? What can
private
you do?
Right of action? You can sue
individually. You can sue.
Yes, you're not dependent on a state AG bringing a lawsuit as you have under many laws. You can go out and sue yourself. And the penalties are potentially significant because they're on a per case basis. And so if you get a class action for a number of people, you can get a very large fine under the Illinois law. Texas, Washington also have laws, but don't have that private right of action. Now, one other very important factor in the Illinois law is the idea of biometric information and biometric identifiers. So biometric information is basically a scan or a value. So your thumbprint, your fingerprint, your handprint, your facial scan, retina scan. Now that relates to you, but then the biometric information is then when that information, that is used to then identify you as an individual. And so it ties it back to who you are. Texas, Washington, regulate the latter. Illinois regulates the former as well. So even if it doesn't tie to a particular individual, because it's unique to an individual, they're covering it. And so then, along the lines of the movie clip here, there are a number of companies out there that are having billboard products with cameras attached to them. They will scan a facial scan of people who are going by. And so they'll look for things like age, gender, so forth, to figure out which ad to show to a particular person. There's clearly no notice and opt-out right being given in that context. And so that's the kind of thing that's ripe for lawsuits under the Illinois law. And so you're having a lot of them. Somebody, a plaintiff's law firm in Chicago, my hometown, had found this law. It sat dormant for a long time. But now it's being used. And a lot of companies are being sued. And some companies are deciding not to offer products in Illinois as a result of it. Nest, Google, both decided, you know, certain features of their product are not going to be available in Illinois.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, go ahead.
Can they get around that in those states? By posting a sign and using a 5% consent? The sign says, by entering this store, you are consenting to have your face scanned or be subject to facial recognition?
Theoretically, yes, but I think that's something we'll have to test. Yeah. Is what does consent mean in under that law? I think the consent requirements here are pretty stringent. So it's going to be tough. It's going to be tougher than, say, like a GLBA consent.
This is almost akin to, do you remember it was like 10 years ago where one of the California malls had hey, if you enter our mall, you're tracked. We're tracking your cell phone. We're tracking the RF from your cell phone, so we just know where you're going and stuff like that. And a bunch of shoppers like, I'm just not going in that store. I'm not mm-hmm. leaving. I think it was a whole mall. It's like, we're not going into a mall. We're not leaving our cell phone behind. Yeah, we're going shopping. But we don't want to necessarily be tracked as to, you know, did you go into Victoria's Secret or the chocolate place or the cigar store, you know?
Yeah. It's an important factor because now you're having a lot of brick and mortar merchants who are saying, we want to get the same kind of information that online merchants can get on people. You know, if you log on to an online site, they can track you the whole way through. And so you have a brick and mortar saying, why can't we do the same thing? Well, this is a law that makes that much more difficult.
Yeah.
It would still have the features activated.
We haven't seen anything there. I mean, if your intent is to get a product with 10 features instead of 6 features and you're cognizantly going across, I mean, if I was at the company, I would argue, well, you consented. You absolutely went over the state line for that purpose, you know.
Yeah.
So that's the tact I would take. So.
Yeah, and really the risk isn't so much you doing it, because they could probably get your notice and consent, but people come over to your house. You know, they're not getting their notice and consent if they're collecting information then. So
yeah.
Yeah. Right. Right. Yeah. Yeah, I think that's the way it's practically going to work, at least so far. But I will say, there are several bills in the Illinois legislature to amend this law. Although most of them would leave most of the law intact. We're going to talk about a particular practice in a moment that's being targeted, but I think we can. Go on. Just quickly, and we've talked about this a little bit to some extent. So you have all these various algorithms that are being used. You know, theoretically, you could take a facial an image of somebody, store it locally, and then use it to compare against. It doesn't make much sense to do that. So what you're doing is then creating a trail of data from that image, and so then you don't need the image itself. But I think the last point here is an interesting one, is that quite often the answer to a privacy or security issue that may come up with a particular technology is de-identify the data. Here, how can you necessarily de-identify it?
Yeah.
It's inherently identifying. Many of the features, they're picked out because they are unique to an individual. And so it raises very interesting questions of, how are you going to de-identify this going
on? There's really no more unique part of your body necessarily than your all the different types of combinations and features that you have on your head. So.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, so where are we going? Out in public, government use, right? This is one that's rife for expansion, right, for a lot of different complexities, both from a security standpoint as well as from a privacy standpoint. So law enforcement, whether it's passive, whether it's active, with a lot of the different racial tensions recently, I just noticed almost all the San Francisco police officers that are stationed around, you notice they all have the square cameras on them. I mean, I don't live in California, so I don't notice it as much, but if you go up, when you go outside, right, they all have the little square cameras on their bodies. How many other people's hometowns have the police officers have the cameras on them now? Okay. Are you sure? Is people not paying attention? Or you just were driving so fast past the cop you didn't notice? Okay, a few of you. Okay, good. Yeah. So, right, both in terms of passive, right, but also active. Is it just recording in a record mode for, yep, okay, the guy went ahead and pointed a gun and then you see the police officer shooting them? Fine. But is it also in there, maybe it's looking for bad guys. Maybe it's actually doing facial recognition. Maybe that's the next step in terms of what we're doing there. China's coming out with a more mass surveillance device, right? Nice little monocle that goes through, connected into mini computer type of system, where you're actually going through and literally the officer is going to be looking at all the different faces. Yep, okay, yeah, okay, oops, yep. Yeah. Someone that's on the wanted list over there.
Right. And at this point, I mean, it's explicitly being used to look for suspected people. And so it's matching to a database, but certainly you could use it to look for people with certain characteristics, heightened pulse rate or a certain mood. They appear to be angry or something like that. You could do that as the minority report,
right? Yep. Catching pre-crime.
Yep.
Apply now. We've all seen the different cameras that are on the police vehicles out in public, totally legal, right? Scanning license plates. If you're driving a vehicle, you have to have a license plate on it, sometimes front, sometimes just back. It depends. Imagine the next shift in the next evolution. So every single police car driving by with a dome on top just spins around, right? And it's a camera system or multiple different cameras on top and then just driving by. You are on the street. You are in public. Your right of privacy is diminished. Are they out there looking for the bad guy, the sex offender, the whatever it is? Does that aid them in their search for a bad guy? Someone that's in a school shooting, all the rest. These are issues that are, we're going to have to start to contend with. But I want to remind everyone, it was 2001. Does anyone remember this Wired article? I had gotten it in the, paper copy back then, right? Face scan, Super Bowl face scan. So in 2001, February 2001, they actually pioneered a use of facial recognition software against folks that were attending the Super Bowl. The first time ever in mass, surveillance mode is 2001. So 17 years ago, literally 17 Super Bowls ago, and now we're here at a different place in time, but it's been going on for a while, especially at national security events, Olympics, and other places. Now, of course, the technology has changed and gotten much, much, much more sophisticated, much more accurate. But once again, some of the same questions get called into mind.
Yeah, and it's certainly being used in transportation. We're seeing it already implemented at several major U.S. airports. They're scanning all passengers that go through the for international flights. It's a standard procedure there. And I would point out that in those circumstances, because you're at a border point, you have fewer rights.
Absolutely.
While some uses of the technology, if there are lawsuits that might not survive or they may be curtailed, this one's probably going to continue, certainly at border points, but also at other higher risk areas where you have large masses of people. This thing certainly could continue. It has come under question as to how effectiveness it is, and there are some reports out that are saying, this is of questionable use. It's a lot of people spending a lot of money on these systems, then they don't necessarily work any better than the alternatives do. Yes.
I heard that U.S. immigration is often using that to track who's leaving the country. Uh-huh.
There have been several. You can go to DHS's website, and there are certain different PIAs, privacy impact assessments, that are out there on some of the uses of those technologies. So it's actually all very public. But if you think about it, for those of you that travel a lot, I used to work for Royal Bank of Scotland, i.e. headquartered in Scotland, so lots of flights over. And the GOES system, the Trusted Traveler Program, all that, the things before pre-check are all based off of biometrics, right? I didn't have to wait every single week for an hour at Boston's Logan Airport to egress back into the U.S. I just, popped my eyes over to the screen. Yep, it's me. Nothing to declare, the usual stuff, and walk on out. They've been using that since 2007, at least. But there's some experiments going on. DHS's website has a lot of great information, on these programs.
We'll move ahead to talk about privacy and security. Obviously, it's been a thread through everything we've talked about. The whole idea of using facial recognition for privacy purposes, the privacy concerns that go with it, and the value it has in security. As a gross oversimplification, in the law, there is an idea that you do not have a reasonable expectation of privacy in things that you hold out in public. Granted, it's not that simple, but that's kind of the general idea. We all hold out our faces all the time, but still inherently, we still have some feeling that we have a right of privacy in it. Certainly within the EU, they think that. It's a different way of looking at things. It's stronger, but I think even here in the US, we have some idea that we should be able to hold something private about this thing, even if we do hold it out in public on our own. There's this idea of a creepiness factor. And I think we need to be cognizant of that for the long-term development of these technologies. Because if people don't trust them, don't feel comfortable with them, to the extent they can opt out of them, they will. And you will then lose some of the benefits of them.
So something else that's an issue in terms of, you know, we've talked about how you can actually use facial recognition algorithms, software, to go ahead and figure out who is who, to maybe spot people that are looking happy, sad, glad, all the rest, push out marketing, potential health-wise there. Some other interesting applications that go down, you know, depends on how it's being used, right? But could go down a very, very wrong path in terms of, can you spot people with disabilities? Can you spot people with certain syndromes? Obviously, the most easy, because it's for people to visualize and think about, is Down syndrome. And there's a massive spectrum of how this impacts an individual. But there are certain key markers, certain key elements, certain key traits that can be codified, can be stored, and a machine can be taught to read those and rank them and score them and basically tell what someone might have, what type of health medical condition someone might have or be more prone to and all the rest. Now this gets in a little bit, you know, into a much creepier area. Do they do this in the hospital as you walk in? Do they do this in marketing? Do they do this in schools? Do they actually do this as an assignment of which level of which class you're in? How exactly is this technology used? Insurance companies, right? They're here, right? How do they use this information? How do they gather this information? How do they share this information? This is where, you know, does somebody have a right to actually figure out that stuff necessarily? How do you actually go about that? This is where it gets a little more concerning in terms of the uses and perhaps the overuses of it, especially if people get things wrong or if they pigeonhole individuals into certain different types of medical conclusions where they have not actually done any assessments minus a picture. So corporate environment is actually interesting. We're going to speed through this. We got about 7 minutes left, so we're going to go a little bit quick. Obviously, you guys get it, building entry. Access, permission, identification, authorization. There could be huge impacts here in terms of speed, efficiency, quality, tracking, you know, so-and-so in, so-and-so out. I mean, the HID cards, I don't have, you know, yes, Chris Pearson's card was here, but unless it's paired with the camera, you don't know that it actually was Chris Pearson. I mean, here where you're talking about maybe a card also, but more so a Chris Pearson's face walked through the turnstile. We know that, we can see it, we can record it, we can. Right, this is much better in terms of entry, visitors, access, authorization, and a whole host of other items, especially corporate investigations and cyber investigations. Yeah, you know Bob was there, you know Bob egressed from here, you know that he walked down the hall, you know that he got in his area, logged in, and you know that the printer went on 2,000 pages and you saw Bob egress and, you know, walk a little bit slanted because of the bag of all the papers he was stealing and taking out of the company. You know, there are a lot of different uses. What is this, Jim? What's this buddy punching?
Anybody heard of buddy punching?
So it's really?
Basically, you know, think of it like on the Flintstones. Fred's going to be late to work, and so Barney comes in and punches in for him so that he's not late, doesn't get docked on his pay.
Please do not leave here and start punching each other. We are not liable. We're not responsible for that type of stuff.
So, an attack against buddy punching, a lot of companies are now using biometric time clocks for employees. So you scan a fingerprint or thumbprint in to show that you were actually there on time. And is very effective at buddy punching, so you don't have to take in their card, you'd actually take in their thumb in order to punch in for them. So under the Illinois law, this has been probably the most fertile area for lawsuits. A lot of employers that are doing this have not given notice and consent to their employees, or gotten consent from their employees for this kind of use. And so there have been just a mushrooming of lawsuits in the last couple of years.
And you could have. I mean, it's really tied to a business purpose. You could do notice and consent.
Yeah, yeah. It's a context where it's certainly possible to do, unlike some of these other ones we talked about. But so there's been just a slew of lawsuits. And the vast majority of the bills that have been introduced in this last couple of months to amend the Illinois law go to the buddy punching issue and would exempt companies from the notice and consent requirements for employee use in this kind of way.
I think, Jim, touching in on legal, we've done this throughout.
Yeah, we've covered much of this, and we talked about the biometrics laws already pretty well. Breach notice laws. You've got a few breach notice laws, so you have unauthorized acquisition or access of personal information. Personal information is defined usually as a few elements. But there are a few states that expressly cover biometric identifiers. And they can cover anything from specifically to a facial scan or more generally to biometric items. A number of other states also cover health or medical information. Does that include a biometric scan? Well, certainly you can determine medical things from it, as we've shown. So I think that's the thing to think about as well, is if this information is out there and it gets compromised, if you're keeping it, it could be a security breach.
Yeah. So this is one of those things where, why are you collecting it? How are you collecting it? How are you storing it? What's the onward use of it? You may get it, you may snap everyone's pictures for the next avian flu, right? And thermal temperatures and all the rest. You're doing it for I'd probably argue in that case, a medical reason, right? Really a medical reason, make sure people don't have fevers. Do you need to keep it, right? Or you just need to keep the raw statistics? Yep, 30,000 people passed through Newark today, and 100 of them had temps that were higher, right? You just need the statistics. You don't need everyone's pictures after some point in time, unless you had somebody escape the quarantine zone or something, right? But once again, good to think about. On the controls, this is where it gets fun, really kind of nuts and fun. Can you go ahead and put certain different logos in different, the black and white cross grids on your face, QR code types of things? Can you go ahead and change some of the depth of your face, literally kind of chipmunk mouth, so that you change the depth and all the rest? Can you put on either around your neck, or around your eyes, around glasses, or on your hat, LED lights that will blind the illuminators, right? The cameras have to have good light or have some type of illumination source. Can you do that to kind of blind? This is a person that has a LED hat on, and they're walking down the road up to no good.
Yeah, it's Chris. It's Chris, by the way.
Yes, it is me. They're blinding the camera from reading the head, the face. What types of things can you put there? Other outerwear that you can actually put on and kind of change in terms of appearance. Did we get a hoodie this year at RSA? I haven't opened it up yet. Is it a hoodie?
No.
What is it? Just put no hood. Okay, so sorry, you guys cannot use the hoodie then to disguise yourselves against us. If it was, you can grab last year's, right? Use that to kind of try to disguise your face. But it's interesting in terms of, can you do this? Do you have to do this? Should you do this when you're out in public, or can you just go outside? I'm in Florida. You can't put on layers in the summer. You just keel over. So this becomes definitely becomes something that's more interesting as the technology changes. Not everyone is necessarily right in the biometric, in the Nest, working for Nest or working for a camera company or all the rest business. But this is all, CISOs, cybersecurity folks, raise your hands. Privacy, compliance, legal, vendors. Auditors, people that thought this was a really cool show to go to and just skipping work. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, you guys get the good stuff. There are cookies downstairs for you. So there are lots of different potentials here in terms of how you apply things, what you look at. your company is going to be expanding in this area in terms of the cameras, in terms of controls, in terms of some of the software behind the scenes that gets fitted into the cameras that you have currently, in terms of the biometric protections that you have for different safe and safer zones, usually some of the same stuff we use, right, in our SOC and NOC. So, you know, how are you capturing that information? Where is it going? How's it being shared? Is it going to the cloud? What is the onward use of stuff there? Do you live in Illinois, Washington, or Texas? Who are you? Oh, come on, raise your hand. I can't see that fight. Yeah, okay. Yeah, you guys have homework, right? You guys need to go talk to your folks. So, a lot of things. By June 1, you got some homework. August 1, a few other things, right? Reviewing different terms and notices and all the rest. And I think I had one more slide here for you. Mm-hmm. November 1 and January 1, literally, it's going to take you, right? We've doled it out. And you should be able to download it just so you can email us if you can't find it or something. But also some other items here to talk about. This is something where you are going to want to get ahead of it, understand it, and then socialize it with the Enterprise Risk Management Committee, Chief Compliance Officer, Risk Officer. And depending on what you do, right, I don't know, if you're a defense industrial based company, you get tons of great cameras and software and biometrics all over the place. Mm-hmm. This may be something that goes into the audit committee of the board just as a, hey, FYI, right? Just so they know, you don't want to get caught with your pants down on this one, especially due to the private right of action, the right of class action lawsuits, and it being in some more interesting states.
Yeah, so, and there's one takeaway from all of this, I would say, after you determine, you know, what is your company doing with facial recognition, and what are you considering doing, think about, is it really the right tool for the job? Think about, is this really the best tool to do what we need to do? Or are you doing it because it's something kind of cool? And somebody in senior management thought, oh, this is really neat. We could do something really high tech here.
And we love cool. But go ahead and think about these things. We're at our time, but we do thank you for your time and attention and all the rest. Everyone awake, get some more caffeine, go tonight to some of those parties. We'll stick around and get in questions and all the rest from you. So feel free to come on up. Thank you, guys. Appreciate it. Thank you.